talk to you for a second?
What?
Pino, who's your favorite basketball player?
Magic Johnson.
Who's your favorite movie star?
Eddie Murphy.
Who's your favorite rock star? Prince. You're a Prince
fan. Boss, Bruce.
Prince.
Bruce.
Pino, all you ever talk about is nigga this and nigga that. And all your favorite people are so-called niggas.
It's different. Magic, Eddie, Prince are not niggas. I mean, they're not black. I mean, let me explain myself. They're not really black. I mean, they're black, but they're not really black. They're more than black. It's different.
It's different?
Yeah, to me, it's different.
Pino, deep down inside, I think you wish you were black.
Get the fuck out of here.
Laugh if you want to. You know, your hair is kinkier than mine. What does that mean? And you know what they say about dark Italians?
You know, I've been listening. I'm reading.
You've been reading now?
I read. Anyway, the so-called day when the black man will rise, we were one day, what does he say? We were one day rule the earth as we did in our glorious past.
Yeah, that's right.
What past you talking about?
Pizza and go the fuck back to Africa.
And so it was said, you were Africans. The Europeans came to Africa, captured you, and put you on slave ships, brought you to America, and made you slaves. If you ask most black people today about their ancestry, 9 times out of 10, they can only provide what they were taught. We were Africans, put into slavery, and that's it. But let's rewind and dig deeper for the truth.
And 24. And when you shall see Jerusalem surrounded with armies, then know that its desolation is near. Then let them who are in Judah flee to the mountains, and let them who are in the midst of it depart out.
and let not them that are in the country enter into it. For these are the days of vengeance, that all things which are written may be fulfilled. Verse 24, and they shall fall by the edge of the sword, and shall be led away captive into all nations, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the time of the Gentiles be fulfilled. Now, what should be noted is besides the true Hebrews of Dimona, who aren't respected as Yasharalites in Israel, this prophecy states that Jerusalem will be trodden down by Gentiles. That includes the imposter white Jews. You can also read Revelations 2:9 and 3:9 to confirm this. So now, let's get into it. Ghana, as it pertains to the Ashanti, the Wassa, Fanti, Twai, Agana, Kouahu, and others represented. Most slaves came from within 200 miles of the Atlantic coast, consisting largely of Ghana, Dahomey, and Nigeria. The Ashanti tribe, for instance, migrated from the eastern part of Africa. On page 21 of the Hebrew Heritage of Black Africa, it suggested that most African Americans may largely be of Ashanti and others, considering they lived in the very region near the west coast of Africa. During the 18th and 19th century, it states that the slaves brought to the New World were predominantly from Hebrew descent.
Alright, so let's take a look at something.
Percent of the Negroes brought to America were of Igbo or Igbo, 26% from West Africa, 15% from Senegal and Gambia, and 16% from Sierra Leone. When we look at the word Ashanti, it relates to the word Ashan, which in the Old Testament was one of the names of the cities of Judah, or in ancient Hebrew, Yehuda. This is found in Joshua 15:42. The Ashanti also have many customs that parallel with that of the Torah, one being marrying only within the bloodline of kin or cross cousins. This can be found in Devarim or Deuteronomy 7:3. Neither shall you make marriages with them. Your daughter you shall not give unto his son, nor his daughter shall you take unto your son. Another is Bimitbar or Numbers 36:9. This is the thing which Yahuwah does command concerning the daughters of Zelophehad, saying, let them marry to whom they think is best. Only to the family of their tribe of their fathers shall they marry. Others include Ezra 9:12 and Nehemiah 13:23-20. Another custom is that of separation from women during their menstrual, as stated in Uyikra or Leviticus 15:19. And if a woman has a discharge, and her discharge in her flesh is blood, she shall be put apart 7 days, and whoever touches her shall be unclean until the evening. Other customs include observing Saturday as the Shabbat, wedding dowries, circumcision, and perhaps the most recognized sketch, which is that of the Ashanti ambassador wearing a breastplate with the 12 stones representing the 12 tribes, as did the Luwite high priest. Guinea, as pertaining to the Fulani as well as the Mandinka. Some of their practices include circumcision, blood sacrifices, and the sprinkling of blood on the doorpost as relating to that of Passover story. Edmund D. Morrell also concludes that after the overthrow of the Hyksos, rulers of Egypt, many of their Hebrew kinsmen found their way into the interiors of Africa by the way of Libya. There are certainly Hebrew customs among the Fulani and Hausa. Other customs include that of Bimitbar or Numbers 5:11 through 28. And Yahuwah spoke unto Mishah, saying, "Speak unto the children of Yasharal, and say unto them, If any man's wife go aside and commit a trespass against him, and a man lie with her carnally, and it be hid from the eyes of her husband, and be kept secret, and she be defiled, and there be no witness against her, neither was she taken in the act, and the spirit of jealousy come upon him, and he is jealous of his wife, and she is defiled. Or if the spirit of jealousy comes upon him, and he is jealous of his wife, and she is not defiled, then shall the man bring his wife unto the priest, and he shall bring her offering for her, the tenth part of an ephah of barley meal. He shall pour no oil upon it, nor put frankincense thereon, for it is an offering of jealousy, an offering of memorial, bringing iniquity to remembrance. And the priest shall bring her near and set her before Yahuwah. And the priest shall take holy water and an earthen vessel, and of the dust that is in the floor of the tabernacle the priest shall take and put it into the water. And the priest shall set the woman before Yahuwah and uncover the woman's head and put the offering of memorial in her hands, which is the jealousy offering. And the priest shall have in his hand the bitter water that causes the curse. And the priest shall charge her by an oath, and say unto the woman, If no man has lain with you, and if you have not gone aside to uncleanness with another instead of your husband, be you free from the bitter water that causes the curse. But if you have gone aside to another instead of your husband, and if you are defiled, and some man has lain with you beside your husband, then the priest shall charge the woman to take on an oath of cursing. And the priest shall say unto the woman, Yahuwah make you a curse and an oath among your people, when Yahuwah does make your thigh to rot and your belly to swell. And this water that causes the curse shall go into your bowels to make your belly to swell and your thigh to rot. And the woman shall say, Amen, Amen. And the priest shall write these curses in a book, and he shall blot them out with the bitter water. And he shall cause the woman to drink the bitter water that causes the curse, and the water that causes the curse shall enter into her and become bitter. Then the priest shall take the jealousy offering out of the woman's hand, and shall wave the offering before Yahuwah, and offer it upon the altar. And the priest shall take a handful of the offering, even the memorial portion, and burn it upon the altar, and afterward shall cause the woman to drink the water. And when he has made her drink the water, then it shall come to pass that if she was defiled and has done a trespass against her husband, that the water that causes the curse shall enter into her and become bitter, and her belly shall swell, and her thighs shall rot, and the woman shall be a curse among her people. And if the woman was not defiled, but was clean, then she shall be free and shall conceive seed. Other customs include blowing the shofar or trumpet as relating to the Feast of Trumpets and observing the new moon. Dahomey, as pertaining to the Yoruba, Igbo, and Togo people. Dahomey was one of the greatest trading coasts, not to mention when we look at the Negro land map, we can identify what says KM of Judah, which means Kingdom of Judah. We also see a heathenized variation of this word as Wada, which in the ancient Hebrew is Yehuda. Some customs include using sheep as sacrifice that must be without blemish, as in the Torah of Shemot or Exodus 12:5. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats. Others include keeping the Shabbat on Saturday, circumcision, and get this, the worship of Yahuwah. Pierce Boucher, a French historian, makes reference that an earlier map by Jean D. Anville indicates that the country around Negos was formerly inhabited by Hebrews, Biafra or Nigeria, as pertaining to the Igbo or Igbo, and Yoruba, and some Agala, a Fife. Many have customs that can be related to that of the priesthood. There is a high reverence for the Most High's name, which priests would only utter on the Day of Atonement. On page 49 of From Babylon to Timbuktu, the Israelites of Nigeria were noted to celebrate a New Yams festival, similar to that of the Festival of First Fruits in the Torah. Among other notable things, swarms of locusts would come through East Nigeria, and the Igbos would then collect them as a source of food, also mentioned within the Torah of dietary law. Although many of the Igbo maintain many of the Israelite traditions, many also abandoned the traditions of the forefathers for idolatry, witchcraft, and consulting spirits of the aborigines of Nigeria. As a result, some intermarried with local tribes and also took on similar features. Similarly, many of the Israelite tribes took on features of the communities they were found.
I know from birth I'm a Jew. Only I know that my forefather missed the way.
I grew up alongside every other Igbo youth. We kept on hearing that Igbo people came from Israel.
There was a story my mom told me at the age of 6 years. I never forget. He said, the Igbos are Jews.
Commitment transcends through prayer, practice, ritual, diet, and song.
Senegal and Gambia, as pertaining to the Hausa, Wolof, Mandinka, and Fulani. Captain D. Garrigan lived many years among the Fulani and was struck by their particular knowledge of Hebrew history. Mesha, or Moses, and Abraham were of the same race as they themselves, and the strongest evidence of a direct relationship to the Hebrew Yasharalites is in fact that their chronicles cease after King Solomon. It is then concluded that the Fulani are line descendants of the Hyksos of Egypt. Central Africa, as it pertains to the Bantu, Bamlakike, Zulu, and more. The Bantu people migrated mainly south, so today they occupy nearly the entire southern part of Africa, from the Congo Republic and Zaire on the west to Mozambique. The Limba tribe, or Limbai, a Bantu word meaning non-African or respected foreigner, are also of Hebrew stock. Many of their customs are directly related to those found in the Torah, such as observing the Shabbat, teaching children to honor their fathers and mothers, dietary law, ritual animal slaughter, and circumcision.
To the casual observer, they look and live much like any other traditional Southern African community. But if you scratch below the surface, there are some intriguing differences.
Pleasure.
So, I'll be honest, I came into this village and the first word I heard was shalom.
Yes.
A Hebrew word.
Yes.
How is that possible? How is it that the Lemba are speaking Hebrew?
The Lembas are the original Hebrews, and they were scattered, as you know, and they crossed into Africa. So they were scattered all over. So in South Africa, many parts of South Africa, you find the Lembas were actually Hebrews.
Hebrew. So the Lembas claim to be descendants of ancient Israelites?
Not clear.
They are.
The Lemba story goes like this. Thousands of years ago, they were forced out of Israel and settled in a place called Sena, which is believed to be the present-day Yemen. There, they lived as traders and craftsmen until war or natural disaster pushed them across the Red Sea and into Africa. Then began a slow migration south. Along the way, according to the Lemba, they built great stone cities. It's a claim that's fascinating. Himmler is convinced that Lemba ancestors did it.
They're also discouraged from marrying outside the tribes. Most Black Americans are not directly related to the Bantu. This, however, is not to rule out the Bantu as Hebrew stock, but only suggests that the portion of Negro slaves that were transported to America may not be directly related. However, there is an estimated 60% of Bantu that were sent to Brazil. Brazil has the biggest population of Black people outside of Africa, due to some 5 million slaves being shipped to its shores. It should also be stated that the Negro slaves were transported to various countries, including the UK. Some of the customs of those in the Congo, for example, include funeral customs which parallel with that of the Bible, such as sackcloth and ashes. Ethiopia, as it pertains to the Falasha and those of Hebrew descent only. It's suggested that some may be Hebrew stock through King Solomon and Queen Makeda through their son Menelik or Benalakim. It can be established that the Queen of Sheba came to see King Solomon as mentioned in 2 Chronicles 9, but the remainder of the story, whether a relationship transpired or not, can be found in a book called Kebra Nagast, page 30, paragraph 35. To summarize the backstory, when Queen of Sheba came to see King Solomon, or King Shalima, there's an occasion that she slept over, mind you, in separate beds, but of the same chamber. Now the excerpt. Then Shalima, or Solomon, said unto her, "Am I prehence free from the oath which thou hast made me swear?" And the queen said, "Be free from thy oath, only let me drink water." And he permitted her to drink water, and after she had drunk water, he worked his will with her, and they slept together. And after he slept, there appeared unto King Solomon in a dream a brilliant sun, and it came down from heaven and shed exceedingly great splendor over Yasharal, or Israel. And when it had tarried there for a time, it suddenly withdrew itself, and it flew away to the country of Ethiopia. It shone there with exceedingly great brightness forever, for it willed to dwell there. And the king said, "I waited to see if it would come back to Yasharal, but it did not return." This dream or vision is that of having a son come forth and then not return again. Page 32. And the child grew, and she called his name Binyalakim. And the child reached the age of 12 years, and he asked his friends among the boys who were being educated with him and said unto them, "Who is my father?" And they said unto him, "Solomon, the king." Also stated within this book is the return of Menelik to his father Solomon. Upon returning back, others of the kingdom joined him, priests, sons of nobles, men, and others. Some customs include circumcision on the eighth day as stated in the Torah, and keeping of the Shabbat, as well as dietary law. Page 38. And the priests and the officers and the counselors answered and said unto him, "Do thou send thy firstborn, and we will send our children also according to thy wish." And then they made ready to do for them, i.e. their children, what it was right to do, and to send them into the country of Ethiopia, so that they might reign there and dwell there forever, they and their seed from generation to generation. Now I would like to provide a list of African tribes of Hebrew descent. The Wassa, Sumgala, Fike, Calabar, Igbo or Igbo, Limba, Yoruba, Ashanti, Fulani, Hausa or Eel, Congo, Mandinka, Bemelikite or Grasslanders, Ga, Tutsi, Senegalese, Wolof, as well as others I have to do more research on. For those of you brothers and sisters pertaining to any of these tribes, you are not Africans, as many of you might already know. You are different. You are Hebrew Yasharalites, descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and the Bible is your true history and culture. The land of Yasharal, or Israel, with bigger borders, is our homeland, currently occupied by imposter white Jews and other Gentile people. Now, other places to look into are Angola, Ethiopia, Ghana, Libya, Sierra Leone, Mali, Benin, Gabon, Liberia, Cameroon, Togo, Guinea, Senegal, Zimbabwe, Morocco, Uganda, Nigeria, Gambia, and of course those scattered all over in various other countries. Now I know that there are some who believe only blacks of America are Israelites, and there are some who think they are only in Africa, but prophecy is clear. Yeshayahu or Isaiah 11:11, and it shall come to pass in that day that Yahuwah shall set his hand again the second time to recover the remnant of his people, who shall be left from Assyria, and from Egypt, and from Pathros, and from Cush, and from Elam, and from Shinar, and from Hamath, and from the coastlands of the sea. Zephaniah 3:10. From beyond the rivers of Cush, or Ethiopia, my worshippers, even the daughter of my dispersed, shall bring my offering. Also, Ezekiel 36:5. Therefore, thus saith Yahuwah Elohim, surely in the fire of my jealousy have I spoken against the residue of the heathen, and against all Edom or Idumea, which have appointed my land into their possession, with the joy of all their heart, with despiteful minds to cast it out for a prey. This clearly speaks of Edom and Gentiles being in the land, as well as scattered Israelites being in Africa, Ethiopia, and also the islands of the sea that includes America. Yirmiyahu or Jeremiah 31:8. Behold, I will bring them from the north country and gather them from the ends of the earth, and with them the blind and the lame, the women with child, and her that travails with child together. A great company shall return here. As spoken of in Luke, more than a million Hebrews fled into Africa for refuge to escape Roman persecution in 70 AD. Later, the Mohammedan also shot and persecuted Hebrews found in Africa. On page 89 of From Babylon to Timbuktu, it states that the Hebrews migrated and inhabited such places as North Africa to East Africa, including Ethiopia, gradually migrating with various kingdoms towards West Africa. It stated that the primary reason for these migrations was to escape persecution from the Arabs and surrounding African tribes who were united against the Hebrews in Africa. The other reason pertains to the trading commerce between Senegal and the Niger rivers. As it should be stated, many of the Hebrews brought their laws and traditions with them after fleeing into Africa to escape persecution. What should be noted is that some small few indigenous tribes did absorb into the Hebrews after the settlement in various regions of Africa. According to Ildad the Danite, the people of the exterior spoke ancient Phoenician, which we understand to be ancient Hebrew mixed with Arabic, considering the Islam conquest and persecution of those in Africa. During the Moorish empires, those of Hebrew descent fled from Spain to escape persecution and came into Morocco for refuge. As it pertains to us who are descendants of those Hebrews in Africa who were taken into slave ships, Devarim or Deuteronomy 28:68. And Yahuwah shall bring you into Egypt again in ships by the way of which I spoke unto you. You shall see it no more again, and there you shall be sold unto your enemies as male and female slaves, and no man shall buy you. In this verse, Egypt represents slavery. The first time the Hebrews entered into slavery was in Egypt. The second time spoken of in this verse is pertaining to the slavery by ships, paralleling with that of the Negro slavery into various countries. The last part of the verse, as pertaining to no one shall buy you or sell you, can be found in the Torah, Vayikra or Leviticus 25:48-49. After he is sold, he may be redeemed again. One of his brethren may redeem him. Either his uncle that is near of kin unto him of his family may redeem him, or if he is able, he may redeem himself. So, a brother or family member could buy your freedom according to the law within the Torah. So, why were we exiled out of our land and why did we go into slavery? Yirmiyahu or Jeremiah 16:11-13. Then shall you say unto them, because your fathers have forsaken me, says Yahuwah, and have walked after other gods, and have served them, and have worshipped them, and have forsaken me, and have not kept my law. Therefore will I cast you out of this land into a land that you know not, neither you nor your fathers, and there shall you serve other gods day and night. where I will not show you favor. So I say to you, as Yasharalites, we must return back to our Heavenly Father, put away false gods and wicked customs, and keep His laws, statutes, and commandments. All praise and glory belongs to Yahuwah, our Heavenly Father, and to Yahushua HaMashiach, Messiah, and the Holy Spirit. I hope that those who see this find it insightful. And as for my Hebrew African brothers and sisters, from your brother, a descendant of those taken captive on those ships that led to America, I say, May Ha Alahim U Abraham, Ha Alahim U Yitzhak, U Ha Alahim U Jacob, Barakata U Shabbat Shalom.
Kunta, the eldest son,
Kunta,
left the village to make a drum, and that was the last time that he was seen.
My God. Again.
The eldest Kunta, son, Kunta, left the village to cut a tree, to make himself a drum. And that was the last time that he was seen.
And he say, he was out in the woods, not far from his village, cutting down a tree to make himself a drum. And when he was doing that, that's when the slavers clutched him. And he never sees mama and his papa again in his whole life. You old African, I found you, Kunta Kinte. I found you.
Yo, African, be Kunta Kinte. Kisnala.
Nsante yala. Nekene kinyon kohamne.
Praise be to Allah for one long lost to us whom Allah has returned. Welcome, son of Kinte.
Sorry to set you here.
Welcome to your village. She says, we are you and you are us.
Thank you.
السلام لك
كنت
عليكم السلام. My cousin Kinty.